morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Oh, so good to see you here in spite of the rain and et cetera. And good morning to you on Facebook. As always, we start off with a song. And this particular song, just to give a little testimony about part of my life, it lives with me in my heart and in my mind. I'm kind of an old guy, being 87 years of age, but I'm a young Christian because I didn't come to Christ until I was 71 years old. And there's wonderful people who led me there, most notably my wife, Tavy, but Brother Eddie and Brother Calvin. But anyway, about the long time that I gave my heart to Christ, I heard this song. I heard it, but then I listened to it. And I said, oh my goodness, to myself, I said, somebody wrote a song about me. But it's a song about a lot of people also. But it stays with me in my mind and in my heart through the years. And when times get tough, I sing it to myself and everything because the lyrics mean so much. It's a reminder of where I came from. It's kind of reminds me and makes me think of what if I hadn't given my heart to Christ, what would have happened. But this song just stays with me. And just most recently when I was hospitalized with the COVID, I was singing this song. And you know, we don't have to ask Christ to be with us anytime, because he's always with us. He always has us by the hand, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. He's always there. So, anyway, thank you for listening.
Valley to rise, down on my knees, rise to
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
We need a word from our pastor, Pastor Eddie. Eddie had a meeting yesterday.
Oh my. Had a what?
He had a meeting, but it was an M-E-E-T. It was a M-E-A-T-I-N-G, and he won.
And he gave him a beating.
He got the beef.
Well, it wasn't quite like that, but it did work out. What he's referring to is I bought a smoker last summer and decided that since I loved barbecue so much, I'd just make it for myself. And my son-in-law invited me to join him at his place for a cook-off and asked me to cook. I said, well, I'm not sure I'm going to be ready to do something like that. So anyway, I did. And I won first place in brisket. So,
all right.
Pastor. Of course, it was just me cooking the brisket. No, there were 17 other guys cooking, so.
Pastor, I just want to remind you that they're relaxing the rules on social distancing, so we could probably have a meal.
Yeah.
Just keep that in mind.
Well, there was no social distancing yesterday.
We all like brisket, I'm just saying.
Yeah. We're ready for.
Yeah.
For what?
Amen. I'm ready, so we'll be thinking about that. Look for that this summer. Yes, Mr. Watson. Well, we gave all the leftovers to the fire department. The HOA furnished the opportunity, gave us gift cards to buy the meat with, so we turned it, and it was the fire department that judged the meat, so it was good. So, yep. Ah, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Olive Place Baptist Church. We're so glad you're here today. And in this rainy day, and I think it's going to be a rainy week if the weatherman's right. We kind of hold that with a grain of salt, right? Mm. But I'm glad you're here. And those of you watching by Facebook, join in today in our service together. We're so thankful that you are here and ready to worship God. This morning, the worship folder that you received, a little thicker than normal. That's due to the fact that today is Gideon Day, and our good friend Jay Summers, who's with Gideon International, is here today to speak to us concerning what goes on in the life of Gideons and in the story that produces so many wonderful blessings through the decades for people to come to know Jesus Christ. And so, without being ashamed of saying, at the end of the service, he'll stand at the back, and if you would like to give him some money for Bibles, that would be greatly appreciated. You may not know, but every Gideon is self-funded, so wherever they travel, whatever they do, that's on their dime. And so today is on his dime as he speaks to us. But every penny that is given to the Gideons is used for the production and the distribution of scriptures. So I just wanted you to know that. We've been doing this for since I've been here with the Gideons. Enjoy it so much. He'll speak to you in detail about so many more things, but just let me introduce you to the little flyer that you got here from the Gideons. There's a place there if you can't give today. There's an envelope, it's already addressed, and you can put your donation in there. It'd be greatly appreciated. He'll probably speak about those who would like to be a part of helping in his effort to share God's word as well. So we will hear from him in just a moment. Also, in your worship folder, there is a welcome sheet. I know if you've been here more than three times, You feel like we know that you're here, but it would be really good if you get back in the habit again. We've gotten out of a lot of habits with COVID. You just tear that portion off, put your name there. If there's any updates that you might have related to your phone number, your address, anything along that line, please let us know. And the most important part is prayer requests at the bottom. If you have some, we would appreciate that you put those there. You can fold this up and lay it in the pew, and we will pick that up after the service today. If everything is good, then everything ought to be all right. But unfortunately, we live in a world where more people think wrong is right. And with that kind of mindset, it is even a greater opportunity for us to live with a principled life, that people would know that it does make a difference when you live for Jesus, when Jesus is in your life. And I just wanted to read this verse, these few verses from the English Standard Version in Ephesians chapter 3, starting with verse 14. Paul says, "I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the height, and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God." May all of us realize that God is here to fill us. And that filling is a blessing in and of itself. And often our lives lead us in directions where we forget the fact that the fullness of God surpasses all of the obstacles that ever lie in our way. So let us be focused on God today. Let us bow before Him as Paul did. And let us receive His Spirit into our hearts that we might grow deeper in Him. Let's pray. Father, we thank You this morning for another opportunity to worship You, to worship You in spirit and truth, for You are the Spirit and You are the truth. And Lord, we want our lives to be mirrored after You, to be in the likeness of You, to grow in the kind of love that You loved us with. Lord, let that begin here today, in every heart and in every way. For Father, You are the Father of all. But Father, You are the Redeemer of those who believe. We thank You, God, that You are the one who sees us no matter where we are or what we're doing. Father, You track every step. You know every hair that's on our head. And Father, You know every tear that falls. I know, God, because of Your all-consuming love for us, Your sovereign power over the universe, that there is no better place to be than right here today, in Your presence, with Your people, expressing our hearts through song, and Lord, allowing our hearts to be molded and shaped through Your word. And Lord, may our giving enhance all of the things that we see that are the needs of this church and in the world today. We thank You for Your love once again, that love that came to us through a cross, and Lord, shone brightly through an empty tomb, and now resides at Your right hand. Lord Jesus, we thank You so much for today's opportunity to even walk with You closer. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Jay, would you come share with us today, please?
Is the placement of God's word important? Yeah. The psalmist declares,
give a Gideon card, the greeting card that changes everything. Gideon cards are beautiful expressions of faith, hope, and love. Unlike other greeting cards, Gideon cards are actually free. And when you give a Gideon card, you donate scriptures that God can use to change lives for eternity.
I picked up a Gideon's Bible and read it and became immediately peaceful in a way
that I had never.
Many of you may know or may not know that Tasmania is a little island, is an island state around 300 miles from Melbourne, Australia. It is serviced by aircraft from two overnight ferries from Melbourne and one ferry from Sydney. These ferries are like luxury liners, and they carry about 600 cars and 1,250 passengers. And the Guineans have the privilege of placing Bibles in these ferries, in the cabins. And the Guineans were checking one of the cabins and found a Bible that had been underlined in blue. Every word on every line, all 1,270 pages. And he thought, you couldn't speed read the Bible in the time it takes to make a crossing. And he wondered how this could happen. But then he turned to the back and found the answer to his question on the little blank sheet in the back. And the message said, I have all kinds of financial problems and family problems, and nobody seems to care. He says, I found this Bible in my room and read it and found that someone does care, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
He said, I had not booked a motel to stay in when I there to commit suicide. He said, so I stayed on board until I finished reading it. And it took me three crossings. So he says, now I'm going back to put things in order for my creditors and my family. So God's word does bear fruit.
Amen.
Most of you are familiar with the Guineans, work of the Guineans. But you may not know that currently we have more than 260,000 Guinean auxiliary members around the world. These are, if you will, missionaries working on your behalf in their hometowns, in their home countries. They don't have to return on furlough or to have their visas renewed. They are your representatives doing your work. Our purpose is the same as your purpose, individually and as a church, to win lost men, women, boys, and girls to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Because we do this by placing the word in the hands of school children, college students, in hotels and motels, hospitals, convalescent homes, penal institutions, and wherever the doors are open, we are placing the word. This last year, it's been kind of slow because so many doors were closed because everyone was afraid of spreading COVID. But we're opening back up, and hopefully this year will be much better. We believe the Lord would have our auxiliary also to place Bibles like this in the waiting rooms of doctor's offices, dentist's offices, and other medical clinics, and a little white, what we call a medical testament, in the hands of nurses and other medical professions in various medical fields. And if we are faithful to do this, God will bless in a miraculous way. A nurse named Sharon reported for duty one particular evening at the where she worked at the large hospital downtown. And as she arrived, she could hear Tom from the nurse's station crying out. He constantly cried out for God and someone to help him ever since he had been admitted a few days earlier with sclerosis of the liver. He was getting worse and nearing death, and he knew it and was crying out for help. His nurse thought it was funny and mocked him. But along about 2 in the morning, she became weary of his cries and his pleas for God. And she came to Sharon and asked Sharon to go and keep an eye on Tom while she had a break, because she was weary of his cries. And she said, try to calm him down if you can. So she went in to his room, and she read passages from the little testament she'd been given by the Gideon Auxiliary. And then she asked Tom if he'd ever accepted Christ as his personal Savior, and he indicated he hadn't. And she asked if he would like to receive Christ as his Savior, and he nodded yes. So she went to the back of the testament, and where the plan of salvation is, and she led him to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. She talked with him for a few more minutes, and he fell asleep. He slept calmly, or peacefully, the rest of the night. He had received what he was looking for, the assurance of salvation and peace that comes with that. Not only is God blessing the world, Guinea's International, here in America, but in some 200 countries around the world. 180 of these countries, they cannot afford to purchase scriptures. They cannot raise the funds because the income for many of the people in many of these 180 countries is like $45 a year. So it's appalling. But we have to provide the scriptures for them, for the Gideons in those countries to distribute, and we gladly do that. You might help. So that's why we come and do a report on a regular basis in your church. So many people have asked, why is it we've received so many testimonies like that of Dave Dravecki, Oral Hershiser, and Ethel Waters, who have come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ through reading a Gideon-placed scripture. Amen. Well, the only thing I can ask to say is that because of the prayers that are going up on behalf of the placed word, God is answering those prayers by people, prompting people to pick up and read the Bibles that we place. So we're placing scriptures at the rate of about a million every 4 days in some 200 countries around the world. Secondly, we don't only need your prayers, we need your support. We need your help. If you are a business or professional man and are a member of a local church and know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and are looking for additional avenues of Christian service, we'd love to speak to you about becoming a member of our organization and helping us with the manpower needs to meet these needs here in our local area. So I'd be delighted to work with, to speak to you after the service about getting membership. Thirdly, we need your financial support. I make no apology about asking for funds to purchase scriptures. We need money to print them and ship them. And every penny that we collect goes for that purpose. And you also, I'll be standing by the door, as your pastor said, to collect anything that God lays on your heart to contribute to purchase these scriptures. And you also, and I didn't bring a Gideon card with me, but he mentioned the fact that there is an envelope in the back to. If you didn't come prepared to give today, you can mail one in a little bit later in the week. And I'll be, we also have it in your hallway out by the front door. There's a card rack for getting cards where you can donate Bibles in honor of someone on special occasion or in memory of someone who's going on to be with the Lord. But we have a video that can explain it better than me. So
give a Gideon card, the greeting card that changes everything. Gideon cards are beautiful expressions of faith, hope, and love. Unlike other greeting cards, Gideon cards are actually free. And when you give a Gideon card, you donate scriptures that God can use to change lives for eternity.
I picked up a Gideon's Bible and read it and became immediately peaceful in a way that I had never experienced at the time.
Each year, Gideon's place some 90 million scriptures into the hands of people in over 195 countries all over the world. Gideon Cards, send the word and change a life. Visit sendtheword.org today. Gideon Cards, send the word and change a life.
Jay, thank you for coming to share with us. And I was just thinking about, I like to read a lot of books on business and stuff like that. I can't imagine any of the books that I've ever read talked about how their salespeople do it for free. No income, everything that I was reading yesterday, negotiating wages. You know, percentages and things like that. This enterprise that you're a part of is absolutely amazing. That organization throughout the world accomplishing all that's being accomplished with just the funds going to basically provide the product that changes people's lives. I love Jesus, do you?
Yes.
Let's sing about it. That word goes forth.
There is. Sweetest name on earth.
free grace. Nothing that we've done to deserve it. Yet it changes lives. Robert Mason.
There is a river of gladness that pours from Emmanuel's veins. The sinner was plunged beneath the flood and got saved. Since then I walk in forgiveness. All of my guilt was erased. Chains of the past broken at last. I got saved. I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. I got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. How could I want more? I've received nothing but goodness. I've tested and tasted your grace. I was so lost, I fell at the cross and got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. How could I want more? The love of God gave me his heart. The love of God won't let me say the same. The love of God pulls me up higher. His will is stronger. That's why I got saved. I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. How could I want more? I'm undone by the mercy of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I've got Jesus. How could I want more? I've got Jesus. How could I want more?
God's word says exactly what it means, and you've got to read it to know what he means. Sometimes we express our love for God, it's beyond our words, right? So deep are the emotions inside of us that God understands. He listens to the prayers of our hearts. Listens to the directions of our minds, but the words that he hears.
Words cannot express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing a song of praise and Scripture, we saw that you breathed life into dry bones. We can't imagine that, Lord, but we feel dry ourselves sometimes. And we feel the hopelessness of death invading our very being. And we need your words, Lord, to help us see the truth. When we read your word, what we see is not just what we get. What we see is all there is.
Father, may your word move our hearts today. Help us to recognize words that we've heard many, many times before. This time, help them land. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Noel. Take your Bibles, if you will, and open them up to the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 12. We're going to continue in our series, Principle, What Faith-Filled Living Looks Like. You know, you can't tell much about someone's faith until you see someone walk through the fire, live through the fire, difficulties, adversity. This is where we focus on faith. And as we began this series, we talked about, last week we dealt with Mother's Day, but as we began this series 2 weeks ago, we focused in on how we get principled and had to do with the point of having perspective, where you see yourself, God, in this. Today I want to talk to you about the fact that what you say is what you get. Your words matter. We use our words too loosely sometimes, and we don't consider the power that's possessed in words. A scientist by the name of Masaru Emoto, back in the 1990s, conducted an experiment on the impact and the power of words. And so he perceived his experiment by using water. He realized that pure water, when it freezes, and that scientific name for that is ice, that it leaves little crystals within that purest form of water that turns to ice. Many sometimes are even in the shape of snowflakes. So what he perceived to do is that he began to have his class speak to those, to that water, to that frozen water. Actually, it was water, pure water. And they would speak good words. And as they spoke good words, he also asked them to take with another jar and to speak harsh words, unfriendly words, to a jar of water. So he freezed the water, the one in which his class had spoken harsh words to. And as it froze and as he looked at it through the microscope, he noticed there were no crystals. In fact, it was rather murky. There were seemed to be lumps of some type of substance forming. It just became murky water. But the jar in which they spoke good words, uplifting words, affirmative words, when it was frozen, the crystals appeared, bright everywhere. So unbelievable, right? So he took it a step further, and so he took and cooked rice, white rice. And he put rice in a jar. And for 30 days, he had his class, two jars of rice, speak affirmative words to one jar and negative words to the second jar. And at the end of that 30 days, the rice that was spoken with affirmation, with good words, was just as white and fresh as the day it was cooked. The other jar in which negative words were spoken, that jar of white rice turned into a messy mulch. Now, when I read that, I'm going, what? But it's true. Look it up for yourself. It is an actual fact that words spoken in the affirmative lift and accelerate, and words that cut and words that damage, they destroy the substance that receives those words. What you say is what you get. Notice what the writer, Matthew, has to say in Matthew chapter 12, that Jesus shares with us this incredible knowledge of understanding the impact, this principled impact about what we say and how it matters. Be reading from the English Standard Version. In Matthew chapter 12, starting with verse 36, it says, I tell you, Jesus says, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give an account for every careless word they speak. For by your words, you will be justified. And by your words, you will be condemned. Your words matter. My words matter, your words matter, the words of the church matter, and the Word of God matters. Let us not neglect this important key to having a principled life that lives with the fullness that God intends for us to have and to live out in this world. You see, I believe that he points out for us some significant things that I want to expound upon from these verses, leads me into this direction about speaking God's word. Okay? You know, you can go into a lot of different settings, a lot of different places, and what you hear are people using God's word in derogatory ways. I've been there, you've been there. Let's not pretend it does not exist. I don't know about you. Now, I don't get so offended that I just shrivel down and die, but I stand firm in what I believe and how I speak. Because you see, if you can speak to crystal clear water and pollute it with harsh words, just think what you can do to a soul in the words that you speak. My whole instinct is to say that I need to do an account of my words. I would suggest that you consider the same. So let me suggest these things as we recognize the power of words, specifically the Word of God. We need to speak God's Word. First thing I want to share with you, we need to speak God's Word into your own life. Speak God's Word into your own life. What does this mean? Repetition after repetition of verses of Scripture. Well, that certainly helps. The only problem that I've found, a lot of people have memorized God's word and don't speak it right. They don't speak affirmative words. They can almost quote the Bible to you, but yet what you hear them say is not what you need to be hearing. So it's not just about memorization. You see, the filling of God into your life is that those words become your life. It's interesting to note that we talk to ourselves. Have you ever thought of that? Okay? We talk to ourselves. Most of the time we do it silently. The older you get, you kind of find yourself talking out loud what you're thinking. But did you know that when you're talking to yourself, that you can speak 4,000 words a minute? What I'm speaking right now is 25% less than that. So it is important to speak to yourself concerning the words you speak, concerning God's word in your life. And we could have a great study and spend 52 weeks this year talking about this subject, about how we speak, and honestly pull it all from the life of David. Because if there was ever a caricature, a person that you could watch go from the time God called him to the time God called him home, you would notice his words and how they developed and how they changed and how they became words in which God himself said, "This is a man after my own heart." After all, he put together, penned much of the Psalms for us to hear him speak. Now in 1 Samuel, in 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6 in the King James Version, we get this little piece that it says here. "But David encouraged himself in his Lord." David encouraged himself in his Lord. He spoke to himself. He spoke words of life to himself. He spoke what God was speaking to his heart. This is what's so important as you speak God's word into your life. Just let me give you a few examples here. In Psalm 42:5, listen to what David says. When am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. David doesn't write that when everything's going well, when everything's coming up roses, when the clouds have cleared. David is saying and singing those words when he's walking through the valley of the shadow of death. Listen to him again with that context. Why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. How can he do that? Because he's moved himself. He hasn't just encouraged himself. He has encouraged himself in the Lord. You can encourage yourself. I can do this. I can get through this. But I want you to know, you have limits. You have limits. My sister and I are discovering on a daily basis the limits a human being has in their ability to perform, in their ability just to respond, in their ability to communicate, in their ability to walk, in their ability to respond to your instructions. We have limits. And those limits are based on our flesh. But when you recognize that your limits are boundless because of the Savior that indwells you, you can begin to speak the words that begin not only to change your life, but they change others' lives as well. What we say is what we get. Notice something else David said in the Psalm. Psalm 103. Verses 1 and 2, you've heard this one often. From the English Standard Version again as well. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." And he finishes off this way. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits." Oh, if we could only capture that within our soul, in our heart, that God, no matter what we're walking through, no matter what we're living through, God is the one who blesses our soul. Those are the words you need to be speaking to yourself. Those are the promises that you need to allow to indwell you. Because this world will do all it can to dismantle your thinking, to redirect your speech, and to make you just another person in the big cog of life. God has called us into his light, and we are not puppets, but we give ourselves to him. We surrender our life to him, and we do that with the words that we say. David says very clearly that God's the one who blesses his soul because of how he thinks and speaks to himself about who God is in his life. Do you do that? speak to God and speak Him into your life. The second thing that I want you to notice that comes to me from reading Matthew chapter 12, verse 36 and 37, we need to speak the Word, God's Word, into every situation we face. Don't wait for your situation to arrive, but when it arrives, be ready to speak to your situation. Okay? Without sounding too Pentecostal on you, but I think it's something we should give Pentecostals credit for, is they speak to their situations. They speak out loud to their situations. This is not something held by a certain sect of Christianity. This is something that the Word of God directs us to do. Word of God is, this verse is for Pentecostals, and this verse is for Lutherans, and this verse is for Methodists, and this verse is for Catholics, and this, all of these verses are for Baptists. No. The Word of God is God's Word. And it applies to everyone, including sinners. What we say about that Word in our situation has great impact on people watching us in our situation or walking with us through our situation. Look at this. If there was anything important about our situation and what we face, it's our perspective. As I reach back from the previous week speaking about this, and I tell you, I really have to work in my own life to really hold on to this attitude, because sometimes things just keep defeating you over and over. You get, I can't take this anymore. I can't move anymore. This, your situation becomes paralyzing. If any of you are familiar with Edmund Hillary, his claim to fame is that he scaled Mount Everest, but not on his first try, not on his second try. In fact, as he did it each time, people were then very inquisitive about why he failed. On his third attempt, he finally scaled that mountain. But right before that, after his second failure, and after losing some of his comrades in that climb, he was once again approached by the media, and they asked him, is he done? And he said this, Mount Everest, you have defeated us, but I will return, and I will defeat you. You cannot get any bigger, but I can. This is the approach we should assume with who we are. Because I want you to know that God has planted us in a perfect place. No matter how many mountains you face, you can continue to grow in your faith by the words that you say in Mark, this familiar passage in Mark 11:23. For verily I say unto you, Jesus says, that whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith, I love that, those things which he saith, in our English today, it was those things you say. Saith, it speaks to an action. It speaks to a deliberate direction. Those things that you saith shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. You speak to rice good words, you're going to get good white rice. You speak bad words to white rice, it's going to turn mushy and unedible. The words that you saith will come to pass. There is a positive or negative reaction related to your speech. And the sooner that clicks with you, related to who you are in Christ, will make all the difference in your life. 1 Samuel, I want you to listen to this story. Everybody knows the story about David and Goliath, I assume. Listen to the dialogue that's going on here. Listen to how David speaks. Like I said before, if you follow David's life, you can find out a lot of things about him just on how he speaks his faith. Let's follow along with me here in 1 Samuel chapter 17. David replied to the Philistine, Goliath, "You come to me with a sword and spear and a javelin, well equipped, ready for war. But I come to you in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. Today, the Lord will conquer you, and I will kill you and cut off your head, and then I will give the dead bodies of your men to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know there is a God in Israel." And everyone assembled here will know that the Lord rescues his people, but not with sword and spear. This is the Lord's battle, and he will give you to us. A teenager. Speaking God's name in the most strategic place, in front of the most important people who needed to hear a word of encouragement, of power, of certainty, and most assuredly, without question, faith. He spoke to a mountain, and the mountain moved, not because David was meticulous in picking up five stones out of that little creek bed and putting them in his slingshot. No, I want you to know he hit him on the first shot. He dropped dead, as we say in Texas, deader than a hammer. For a lot of people, that seems to be a gruesome story, but what was happening there was the annihilation, just like it's going on today in Israel. The Palestinians will not give it up. They will continue to attack Israel until God comes again and puts his foot down on his throne and says, enough! There will be no political negotiations. There will be treaties. There will be talks. There will be somebody doing something, but I want you to know those people have been warring against each other from the get-go, because that land they both claim is theirs. And you and I know from the written word, the truth of God's word, that land belongs to God's people and nobody else. Actually, let me refine it to you. That land belongs to God. David put them on notice that there is a God who will take you out. Don't ever think that little stone landed. And wherever it landed, guess who directed that stone at that giant's head? And he will direct you if you will speak truth to those things that are mountains that seek to destroy you. In faith. This was no novice here. This was a shepherd boy. He was well equipped to use that slingshot. God used his abilities to do what God can do. And if you ever think that that was David that did that, you need to reread the story. I just read part of it to you there. And it changed the outlook of Israel, ladies and gentlemen. It changed the trajectory of David's life. When you speak words of faith, it will do the same for you. That leads me to number three. You speak God's word, and your faith will come alive. Speak God's word, your faith just starts to blossom. It starts to grow. And I want you to know, y'all got your lawnmowers ready? It's going to rain this week. You got your mosquito spray out? It's going to rain this week. You know what happens here in Texas. You grow as much mosquitoes as you got grass. Your faith will come alive just as God's reign on the land allows everything to grow. Some time back, McDonald's tried a campaign to up their game. And it didn't go very far because the slogan just didn't catch with anybody. But they came up with this slogan, "Think with your mouth." Now, that makes sense if you're McDonald's, but if you're trying to watch your triglycerides and your cholesterol and your blood pressure, that's not real good speaking, is it? No. And certainly this weekend, I got both of my oldest grandsons here today, which is a real joy, back there listening to me ramble on. But I got to go to Boston's house and cooked that barbecue I was telling you about earlier. And what was so cool was he knew that some kind of event was going on and that I was cooking brisket and ribs, which he likes ribs better than brisket. And he wanted to be a part of that. And so he said, can I sleep with you? Because we were telling him, his dad and I were talking, lining out the routine, because you got to put this thing down when they say you got to turn your stuff in at 3 o'clock, then you got to backtrack. Okay, how long is three different large, huge pieces of meat going to take to cook and it all be done by the time it has to be done? So my son-in-law got his spreadsheet out, and so we had all those categories and we went down. Actually, it worked like a champ, kept us on track. Like, when did I put those on? I don't know. So we were moving through that, but Boston began to understand, well, when you're all going to start doing this? Well, about midnight. Oh. And he said, well, I want to stay up for that. And his dad asked him, you can get up, Boston? Oh, yeah, we can get up. So anyway, we get the thing started. We put the brisket on first and get it cranking and going, and then we go to bed, set the alarm for 2 hours, come back and check on it. And so when my alarm went off, Boston's sleeping over there on the other side of the bed from me, he didn't move a muscle. Well, I thought, well, he's a seven-year-old, and that's kind of how it's going to roll. So I got up and checked it and went back to bed, or tried to go back to bed, because then I thought, man, I'm running this brisket. It's not looking like what I want it to look like. So the second time we got up, which was around 5 o'clock, his dad goes in there and tells him to get up. And he comes out there on the patio, and he's, you know, doing that thing like this and flops over on the chair over there. But he stayed up from that point and helped us get through all of that cook. You see, when you're cooking barbecue, it tastes so good on your mouth, it just keeps you wanting more. To me, it's candy to me. I love that stuff. It's so good. And I reiterated it. I can't believe that I lost the other two. I just knew I had those ribs down right. In fact, I cooked the ribs better than I cooked the brisket. And then I tried something new. If you had never had a beef rib, they call them, we call them short ribs, but there's really nothing short about them. But there's only three bones in this cut meat, rib bones. Those bones are about this wide. And that's how wide that meat is, that wide and that thick on those bones. It's brisket on a stick, literally. Oh, man, it's good. I just knew. Nobody else cooked it. Nobody. I said, we got this. We got this. Nah. No. Didn't happen. That's the way it goes. And that's the way it went with McDonald's. It just didn't kind of pan out like it should have panned out. Sometimes that is with us. Our faith just seems to just fizzle out. We commit ourselves to get up and go with God, but then we just sometimes sleep through it. But listen, if you will speak God's word, those wonderful morsels dripping with truth, dripping with life, your whole being will come alive. In Romans chapter 10, verse 17, Paul says this, so then, faith. In the King James Version, cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Even this moment right now, as I repeat these words from God's scripture, they will begin to weigh in your mind and in your thinking of what they are. I know that. I'm a product of the reality of God's word being heard. You are a product of the reality of God's word being heard. And it begins to develop something in you. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. It comes alive in you. It gets birthed in you. Romans 10, verse 10, backing up just a little bit. Notice the process of this faith aspect of your hearing. For it is by believing in your heart that God, who? Has justified you. You are justified by what you believe in your heart to God. And it is by confessing your mouth, what you say, by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. What you say is what you get. Lord, save me. Lord, help me. Lord, redeem me. Lord, forgive me. Wonderful words. Wonderful words of life. May we sing them over and over and over again to be reminded through our hearing and through our voices that what we say is what we get. Saved! Saved! We should love to proclaim it. We should love to say it. And in Proverbs chapter 18, listen to Solomon, verse 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat its fruits. I want you to notice that what he's saying there is a two-edged sword. Your tongue bears fruit that you will eat. And it can be bitter and mushy, or it can be the most wonderful Wagyu brisket you ever put in your mouth. God's Word. God's Word does that to our faith, and it comes alive, and we live it. Let us commit today to do that very thing, to live God's Word, because we speak it into our lives and we begin to use it in every situation, and we know that as we use it, our faith comes alive from the very first day you believed. I'll reflect on that. Do you reflect on that when I say that, the very first day you believed? Did your mind take you back? Did the Holy Spirit take you back to where you said yes to Jesus? There's still many who do not have that day. There are many who have not crossed that place to speak those words of life. You and I are responsible for them to know and to hear how to say and speak those words of life so that their lives, their faith, will come alive. You're not off the hook just because you believe. No time to rest. No time to sit back and kick back and wait till Jesus comes again. You got to fight for it. And you know, sometimes maybe it would be good for us to fight under adversity. We've been blessed so much in this country. But once again, we take notice of what happens over in Israel. Those folks are on their guard every single day they live. And their enemy cares nothing about life. Their enemy places strategically in between homes and neighborhoods their rocket launchers and missiles, knowing that if they can rile up the Israelis enough, they'll shoot over there, and then all they have to do is go on the news and say the Israelites are so brutal and so terrible, they're killing women and children. The words they say are rotten. The words they say will not allow water to be clean. The words they say cause rice to turn into mush. But the words that God speaks are living water, can never be tainted. And the word God speaks is the bread of life. It can never turn rancid. What are the words you're speaking? What are the words you're saying? I submit that we all begin to realize that what we say is what we get. Let's begin to speak those wonderful words, those words of life to ourselves and to this world. Amen? Let's pray. Father, your word is a great encouragement to us all. And here today, Father, we have been reminded that how we say our words make all the difference in the world. Lord, help us as we speak, knowing that no matter what venue, no place, Father, is to be exempt from your word because we carry it in our hearts. We know, God, that you are our sustainer and our redeemer, our Savior, our Lord. But we also know, Lord, that your steadfast love keeps us steadfast. That no matter what rocks this world will never rock you. In so many ways, people are being shaken, disturbed, and are uneasy about words that are being spoken in the world today. But Lord, those words that either come from a politician or from some individual, Lord, mean nothing compared to the words that you've spoken in your word. Quicken us today, Holy Spirit, to this important resource for our well-being about what our mouth says, for that's what we are. Oh God, forgive us. We failed you. We failed to speak about you. We've failed to speak for you. Forgive us, oh God. But Lord, we know that when we bend our knee and ask for forgiveness, that you will forgive. And when we ask for that forgiveness, Lord, we're going to do our very best never to repeat it, but allow you to build up inside of us more and more as we think about what we say. Lord, as we apply it to every situation and as we allow it to make our faith come alive for others to see. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Noel, let's sing.
You.
Live it this week. God bless you, Jay. Thank you for coming today.